So, this is the year, Brian. We're gonna do
year for,
it.
Year for what?
This is the year to the Mariners.
Oh,
I'm gonna go to the World Series. We're gonna win. Gonna break that 2001 season record. We're gonna win like 130 games. I think we're already off to a good start.
You do realize that we are currently 0-3 right now, right?
Oh.
We're about to get swept by the Houston Astros.
God damn it, Mariners.
There's hope though. Right now it's we're not losing, it's tied. 2-2
Okay.
in the top of the ninth. But the Mariners have two runners on base.
I'd like to make an amendment to my original statement. That's God damn it, Mariners. Don't do this again.
Dude, every year you think it's gonna be the year like, oh, we rebuilt our team, it's great. Right in the crapper.
We win 100 games and then we still lose.
You know what's sad is, you know, Seattle's such a great sports town, honestly. And I know in football we don't always agree, but baseball we both root for the Mariners. But
yes.
It's such a good sports town. I always feel bad for Mariners fans around here because they have nothing to really show for their fandom. But literally every year they think they're going to the World Series, and you could start 0-30, and they're going to be like, "It's okay, we could go 132-0 to finish the season." You're like. That's not how this works. It's baseball.
We just got to resurrect.
All right, so over-under real quick. Before we start moving on here, over-under.
All right.
Are the Mariners going to pull it out tonight or not?
I'm going to go with not.
All right. Well, since I've already looked, I'm going to say they are going to pull it out because they just scored. And now it's 3-2 Mariners. Ryan, you have no faith. You're just one of those bandwagon fans. I've been a loyalist right from the beginning. You are what's wrong with sports.
The kingdom. I know everybody. I can still remember all of their announcements. But Ken Griffey, you know.
Yeah. Well,
all
I saw
that
King
stuff.
Griffey Jr. in his final season at Safeco. Uh-huh.
Yeah, well, I was kind of not living in the state. So I think I get a pass. This is not like the motherfucking Sonics. That's for sure.
I don't want to talk about the Sonics right now.
But we do have a show. We got a show tonight.
Yeah, we do have a show tonight. You haven't tuned into the Seattle local Seattle sports channel. No, you tuned into the Geek Dad Report, so we should probably not talk about sports. I will side note though. I see Ryan is proudly wearing his Seattle Mariners hat. I was going to wear mine.
This is the old logo too.
Yeah, I know. I've got one of those. That hat looks like it needs to be replaced. It's fairly dirty. But
it is dirty.
Yeah, I want to get one of the new ones. It's got an M. But anyway, we're not talking about sports. I was just going to say that I, too, was going to wear my Mariner shirt or hat, but I decided that I wanted to wear the super sweet Lion King shirt, so my Mariner's hat didn't go with it. So I made a fashion choice.
Ain't no passing praise. Kuna Matata. For the rest of your days.
All right, on that note, welcome everybody to episode 97. Is it 7?
97
of the Geek Dad Report. One show dedicated, formulated, specially created, and to not talking all about Mariners baseball, and instead talking about the geek news that was, which wasn't very much, and talking about some things that really just might fire you up. Maybe.
Yes.
And hopefully making you laugh, smile, tell your friends that you love us, all those things. I, as always, am Brian West, the host of With the Mostest, and that beautiful man over there is Ryan Tomlinson.
Hello, everybody.
And together we form the super team of the internet.
Yeah. We don't do it like Captain Planet, where we have to get, like, hearts and all that other stuff. We just, like...
Well, it's like five people that have to get together to form that. Like, no two people ever form... I guess, like, maybe in Dragon Ball, where they do the fusion, we could, like, do the fusion fingers.
Or it could be, like... Firestorm.
We could be Firestorm, I guess, if you want to take him in the comments.
I could be the smart professor one, and you're just the idiot, and I just take your body, and then you get to, you know.
You do realize that you don't take my body. The smart idiot one is always the one who's got the big muscles, and he's the one that rocks the body. So literally what I'm going to do is I'm going to take you, squish you into a little brain ball, right, and I'm going to shove you in the back of my head. Like a chip, and you're just going to make me a little bit smarter, but I'm still going to keep all this. And then when you like talk in my head, I'm like, shut up, Ryan.
I don't think I like this arrangement anymore. I think I'm gonna retract that statement.
No, we're gonna go with that. That's fine. my Dragon Ball statement would have at least given us equal powers, and we would have been like Brian. See, it even works because it's Ryan and Brian, it'd be Brian.
But it's still the same.
But we would have equal partnership in our own body. But you wanted to just be a small chip in my brain. I like that idea much better. I get all the benefits, and you are a floating voice in the back of my head telling me I have to do something, and that just doesn't work for me.
Yes, because we all know that you are not only slightly stubborn, but you will not relent when you want to get what you want.
Chris Ryan, I always get what I want.
Except on some certain occasion.
I always get what I want, Ryan. My wife... There's a reason why we had to date and be engaged for 6 years before we got married. I had to beat her into submission. Yeah, right. Anybody who knows my wife knows that woman will never submit. Ever.
Yes. Ever.
That's okay. That's why I love her. What were we talking about? I don't know.
We
got things to talk about today. We what did we our talking introduction. About on the show? We got... I think I already talked about it. I don't know.
We have some brief news. We have a couple of trailers. We're going to talk about The Walking Dead season finale.
Yes.
And as always, we have some good listener questions from the Faithful 50.
And then we
got some good recommendations for this week.
We do. We also have a quick little topic. We're going to talk about comic books and diversity, something we've talked about a lot, but a very high-up person from Marvel Comics decided to take his foot and insert it in his mouth. But we want to talk about that and say, you know what? I understand what he's saying, and some of it is not wrong. So we're going to have a hot take on something that may make people angry later, which is always fun.
Yes. But as always, we would like to start off with our dad moments of the week. And yeah. I know yours is going to be very funny from just a tiny...
funny, maybe horrifyingly funny, yeah. I guess.
Well, yeah, because Brian, you gave me a morsel of it, and so I'll do mine quick. Mine was that my wife and my son have been doing soccer tryouts for a team. There were like 24 kids. They're only keeping 16, so like the first time, you know, where they're like, you know, he could possibly get cut by, you know, so, but he made the team.
So isn't your son like a mini Pele?
He is a mini Pele. It was for his soccer team, so he made a team. So I just had, like, my really good first, like, well, not my first, but, you know, like, just feeling really proud for him. So that was, like, my super proud dad moment of the week. My son, 9 years old, made his travel club soccer team. But I think your story is going to be a lot better than mine.
Yeah, quick note real quick, because anybody who, any of our followers... send us messages while we're recording. We will always put them on air. Faithful 50 member Evil Chris right now is currently in Vegas, and that son of a bitch just sent me a photo of the slot machine that he's playing. You see that?
Is he playing Wheel of Fortune?
He's playing Wheel of Superman. Look at that.
Oh, goddamn you, Chris.
It's pretty awesome, Chris. You get the thumbs up, the double gold stars, and
I
all of our
see
where, jealousy
what's he
and admiration.
Does he have his drink? Does he have his drink in the picture?
No, I feel like he's there on a family trip. He's probably walking around with the family and just, like, saw it and took a picture of it and kept walking by.
Yeah.
Poor bastard.
I'm going to go see some dolphins.
I've taken family trips to Vegas. I went to Vegas one time with this other group of friends, and I'm telling you, it was the worst trip ever. I'm telling you, those guys were nothing but a bunch of drags. They just were like, oh, let's just go to buffets.
I went on a family trip with some friends, too, and we shared a drink. Walking down the strip, and we had a guys' night out.
Well, you have way cooler coaster. Friends than I do, Ryan, apparently.
So, it was a really good trip, you know.
Dude, the trip that I went on, my buddy almost let my child drown in the pool. It was terrible. It was an awful, all for a picture.
on my trip,
you know, we should probably...
I saved someone.
Okay, me and Ryan went together, so everybody who's watching this has no idea that we are just going off on an inside joke. Yeah. It makes for bad radio, bad YouTubing.
Yes.
Makes for bad... Okay, anyway, my story.
Just remember the one thing in Vegas.
What?
Don't touch the walls because it's covered in poop.
Covered in poop. Or be like my daughter and stick her sister's foot in her mouth after she's been walking on the strip. You know what? Don't know. Don't know. Anyway, but what does that have to do with my story? Absolutely nothing, except for, I guess we can hashtag this bad decisions by child. That's what I'm going to hashtag. So I had the proud parent moment that no dad ever wants to have to deal with, but
yes.
It's something you don't realize you're going to have to deal with until you do, and then you realize, like, oh, shit. It's already that time. So my daughter's about 8 years old, so she's not old by any means, but she's very curious about everything. She likes to learn. She absorbs information like a sponge. She's very perceptive, reads tons of books. I should have seen this coming sooner. My daughter also in school nowadays, which is great. They teach kids how to use computers all the time, and which is obviously a very valuable thing to teach young kids. And they're so much more advanced on computers than we were at their ages, partially because when I was 8, there were no computers. Well, there was, but they were giant house-sized things and, you know, big buildings, and you didn't have one at your house. But anyways, so we have been allowing – we went and had our parent-teacher conferences recently, and they were like, you know, hey, we encourage you to have her work with typing, you know, let her type stuff, get on Word documents just so she can learn to type and get better at it and stuff like that going forward. And so we're like, okay, cool. So we give her a little bit of I've got my old Lenovo that I used to use for the show. I let her use that now. Her and my wife have it. And I let her use it. I let her hop on there. And so we give her a little bit of time every week while we kind of sit and monitor and do whatever. Well, my wife has made the mistake of giving her the password because she's too busy to walk over and type it in herself. So my daughter has remembered this and has hopped on it. Needless to say, a couple days ago, my wife... I'm in the kitchen cooking, and my wife opens the computer in the living room, and all of a sudden I hear her, "What the fuck?" And she looks over at me, just daggers, right? And I'm like, "What?" And she's like, "Come here." I was like, "What?" I walk over, and there's porn on the computer, right? Like one of those dirty porn sites. And you guys all know the ones I'm talking about, you bunch of heathens, because you guys are grown-ass dirty people like me.
Shut up.
And, you know, there's no porn sites anymore where you go like, enter your age and hit enter, and then it's like a picture. No, now it's like you click it, it immediately goes to like 15.
And it's not like you gotta watch it load for like 15 minutes.
Yeah, no, it's not like that. So you're sitting there,
and it's at like, it's right here, and you're like, come on!
Yeah, no. Now it's like it immediately loads to like 20 different cut screens of like the worst shit you'll ever see, and usually there's an animated of some girl getting like DP'd on the side, just going crazy. Well, needless to say, because I'm not, have not been used to my daughter using computers, I have not even thought about parent-proofing or child-proofing my computers in my house. Yes. And so long story short, my wife looks at me and I'm like, hey, fuck you. I have my own computer. I know better than to look at porn on the computer that you and my daughters look at. No. Yeah. And so we pull up the history, and sure as shit, it was the last time my oldest was on it. And she didn't say anything to us, so we call her in and we're like, honey, we're not going to be mad at you, but we got to ask you some questions. Did you click on something on the internet that you weren't supposed to? And you can tell she bit a hold of it because she immediately busts into tears. I did. It was awful. It was terrible. I knew the moment I clicked on it, I wasn't supposed to be there. And I hit the little box and it wouldn't go away. And so she's just crying, right? And I'm just like, you know, I'm angry, mortified, and laughing at the same time because this whole situation is just kind of like, but so anyway, what happened was that she was watching Twilight. This is why, parents, you should never let your kids watch Twilight. Twilight leads to all things bad. But on Twilight, they had talked about sex because her and the vampire and the girl get the hookup. And so my daughter didn't know what that was. And so she decided, because she's learned like anything, you either ask Alexa or you Google it.
And Alexa was like,
you know, and we've always told my daughter, you know, hey, as you get older, if you hear things in school that you don't know, feel free to ask me and your mom. You can ask us anything without us getting mad at you. We'll explain. But she didn't even know what sex was. She didn't know it was dirty, it's not dirty, but she didn't know it was not appropriate for her age. But so she Googled sex and hit the first link, which happened to be some dirty, nasty sex site. Oh, God. And so I'm like, it goes, so I'm like, okay, well, do you want to talk about anything you saw there? And she's like, no, I don't ever want to talk about that. It was awful, it was gross. I'm like, all right. And then she seemed to move on from it. So I'm hoping that nothing scarred her too permanently. And then my wife goes on like a 5-minute tirade. She's like, anything you saw on there is not appropriate, and the women on there are demeaning themselves. And I'm like, Jesus. It's like, when did you take such a hardline stance on porn? Then I kind of got offended. I was like, what's wrong with porn? why are you judging people? They're just working girls trying to make a buck.
Yeah, see, so anyway. Now the thing is, though, is that I'm pretty sure that's going to just happen to every single one of us at some point. Because, like, we do the same thing. We're like, you know, if you're curious, you know, we will let you, you know, try and look up, you know, something on Google, you know, whatever, you know, and we'll try and figure it out. So now I'm just going to stand over my kid's shoulder every single time they're on the computer. I think that's just a good way to...
I've given no one. I'm the only person that has the password to my MacBook because I don't want any of my heathen family on my beautiful Apple computer. But that being said, I'm going to be going on my Windows computer and hitting all the fucking settings that, you know, change it to G-rated websites only.
Yeah.
Except for my wife will probably start yelling at me.
Yeah, so here's the PSA for the week. Change all your website settings.
Yes.
If you let your children use one of your old computers. And delete all your history before you give it to them.
Or buy yourself an iPad, your own personal iPad that you can view all your own personal porn on.
That is also an option.
Or Galaxy if you're so inclined. But you can get a virus on an Android, not an iPad. It's on the commercial.
Or just have a really imaginative imagination.
Or get a video collection of porn, because kids don't know how to use VCRs, so you'll be fine.
Or just have sex with your wife more. Yeah.
Listen, Ryan, like I said, there's a lot of hardworking women out there that I am not gonna lead to their unemployment. We gotta keep America great. Yeah. We gotta bring jobs back, not get rid of them.
Yeah. We all know Donald Trump trying to keep those job numbers up. So
you know what? No, we're not talking about Donald Trump. After everything that's going on right now, I can't handle Donald Trump anymore. So, but you know what I can handle, Ryan? I can handle some Ninja News.
Can you, Brian? I don't know if you can.
I'm going to come with the uppercut of knowledge. Boom. The judo chop of information. Pow.
And the Cobra Kai leg sweep of learning.
Yes.
I don't know what the words are at. What's the leg sweep sound like? Like a swish?
Whoosh. Yeah, probably. Like a really, I don't know, like a good leg sweep would, depends on who did it. Like if it was an Austrian, like if Arnold Schwarzenegger was going to do it, he'd probably be like, yeah. And then do a leg sweep.
I just have like the song in the back of my head whenever I hear it though. It's like, you're the best around.
Nothing's ever going to slow you down. Or keep you down. Slow you down? I don't remember, whatever. Well, you know what did get slowed down, Ryan? You know what will slow you down?
I don't want to hear it.
Running studios. Because you know what just got killed today, Ryan?
I'm going to cry.
King Conan is officially dead.
Crumb.
There will be no more vengeance. Sweet, sweet vengeance dealt with the giant sword. And, well, at least not anytime soon. Maybe eventually.
Yeah, probably won't be Arnold.
Yeah, well, I hope it's not Jason Momoa either.
I'm trying to remember his version.
Yeah, that's the problem. First of all, the movie wasn't very good. He was all right, but here's the problem with rebooting Conan. Arnold Schwarzenegger's take on Conan is iconic. Like, it's hard to recast an icon. You'd be better off doing the son of Conan, which is what they were going to do, the Legend of Conan, King Conan and his son, and kind of pass the torch. It's same with Indiana Jones. It's the reason why Disney said that, hey, we're not going to recast Indiana Jones. There's certain characters, I mean, but then again, I guess they recast Han Solo, so...
Yeah.
So I heard a question real quick, sidetrack, is that I heard somebody ask, it was on another podcast, since Aaron Aldenreich has been cast as Han Solo, if he does a good job, does that mean he's immediately going to be cast as Indiana Jones?
Or he can be Jack Ryan.
Or Jack Ryan, yeah. He starts they cast him as Harrison Ford playing other roles.
It's just a young Harrison Ford again, guys.
But anyway, back to Conan. The writer who was writing The Legend of Conan has come out and basically said that they had a great story. Apparently, it was, and this is going to make it even worse when I tell you this, it was going to be an Unforgiven version of a Barbarian movie. So basically, think Clint Eastwood, think Unforgiven, the old guy coming back for one last ride. I guess Logan to an extent, too. But that was going to be the story. Everybody loved it. Everybody signed off on it. But apparently it was going to be expensive, and they just didn't have faith. The studios, the powers that be, did not have faith that this movie would recap its money, especially considering that Arnold has not made a hit movie in a long time.
He doesn't need to make hit movies.
Well, even his Terminator tanked horribly. Well, I thought Genesis was all right. He was the best part about it.
Yeah, I didn't mind Genesis, honestly.
Listen, whenever you cast Courtney Jai, your movie's gonna tank. That's just how it works.
That's true.
The only role he's ever done that was even entertaining was Captain Boomerang in the Suicide Squad, which he fucking nailed that shit. That was awesome.
Yeah, that was pretty good.
But anyway, I had to bring that up first since I knew Ryan was gonna cry horribly. Yes. But maybe something that'll make him happy is that we're going to get 14 more Transformers movies.
I've seen the second one. That's how far behind I am right now.
So you're indifferent?
I just don't care.
Literally all the same movie. I like Transformers, but they're all the same movie.
And why don't they just do like an animated show? Or just do a live action show? That's what, if he really wants to do 14 fucking... It's basically Michael Bay just wants something to do.
Well,
but not have to put in that much effort for it.
So, well, here's what it is. It's not that they have 14 movies, but they said that they have outlines for 14 movies. So we talked about it a while ago. Transformers, the Paramount, had gotten together and put a really talented writer's room together to kind of map out a universe for Transformers. So it sounds like right now that they have up to 14 different movies already pinned out if they want to go in that direction. Obviously, if this next movie is a big hit, you know, they'll kind of move forward. We've already talked that they have the solo Bumblebee movies moving forward. But I'll be honest, you know, if the box office starts waning for these, I honestly don't see a world where we're going to get 14 Transformers movies. I like Transformers. I think the movies, for the most part, are fun. They are definitely mindless entertainment. I would not call them good by any stretch, but they are fun. Do I think that's enough to carry 14 of them? Probably not.
Yeah.
I mean, Fast and Furious movies are generally pretty good, and I can't see 14 of those. I mean, they're going to try and stretch it to 9, but even that's pushing it.
Yeah, it's Transformers is a good property, but I don't think it's a good property for just doing movies in. I think it needs to be a show of some sort. That's just the way Transformers works for me, honestly.
Well, I don't mind a couple movies here and there. I just don't care enough about the universe to see a lot more movies.
Yeah, because I don't care about the universe anymore. I mean, I saw the first two movies. I was good. That hit enough nostalgic value for me that I was done.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, there are a series of movies, but you know what? They make over $1 billion every time they're released because people around the world love them, so they're going to keep making them. I mean, to be honest, the movie that we all want to see anyway is the Cybertron story, so we want to see all the Transformers. The movie we want to see doesn't have humans in it anyway, so at that point, why not just make it like a Pixar animated movie, which is essentially what it would be if you took out all the humans. Anyway, but I don't know. We'll see it more of that as we go. The new Transformers movie is coming out this summer. I'll go see it. Supposedly, everyone's saying they screened some parts of it at CinemaCon. Some people, everyone's saying it's a Transformers movie.
Yeah, that's all you're going to get at this point. You're not going to get anything less. Not going to get anything more. It's just going to be it's a Transformers movie.
Yeah, it's a Transformers movie. So let us know if you're excited. I will go see it. I'm not really excited, but I think it looks all right. Why not? Something I'm kind of getting excited about a little bit is the new Dune movie is moving right along. I can't say the guy's name. Dennis Villeneuve, the guy who just directed The Arrival, which I haven't seen yet, but I've heard really good.
It's on Amazon Video.
What?
It's on Amazon. Get it on Amazon Video right now for like $5.
No, yeah, I'll wait. I'll wait till it comes on HBO for free $99, Ryan. Psh, I already waited this long. But I've heard good things. I do want to watch it. So he's attached to direct Dune, so that by itself is good news. But I just released that the guy who wrote Forrest Gump has actually been tapped to be the screenwriter for the Dune movie. So say what you want to about Forrest Gump, whether you liked it or didn't. It had a good script, and... Eric Roth, who's also, I don't know, he did, let's see, what else did he do? I don't know. I click on the link right now.
All I know, Brian, is that spice is like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're going to get.
I feel like you do know what you're going to get. It's called spice.
Yeah, I pretty much do know what you're going to get from spice.
Oh, here we go. Here we go. So, thanks for stalling. Eric, Mr. New screenwriter for Dune, he's also written, besides Forrest Gump, he wrote The Insider, Munich, Ali, and The Curious Case of Benjamin Button. All very good movies.
All shitty movies.
All absolute garbage. I mean, what a loser.
I don't think even one of them was, like, nominated for anything at the Oscars.
Nominated for Razzies because they were crap.
Yeah. Yeah.
Absolute garbage.
So, evil Chris can rest assured that Dune is properly doomed.
Yeah, well, you know what else is garbage, Ryan?
What is?
Our reporting. Because last week I reported that Zack Snyder, thinking Transformers.
Well, same thing.
Justice League was going to be 170 minutes long, which for you people who can't do simple math, that's 2 hours and 50 minutes, and I was ecstatic. Well, apparently Zack Snyder has crushed that rumor. He said that it will not be 170 minutes. He said it will be 300 minutes. Woo!
Wow.
5-hour epic, everybody. Yes.
That's exactly what we need, honestly.
I expect no less. No, he said it's going to be more along the lines of the Batman v Superman, so I'm guessing it'll probably still be clocking around 2.5 hours. Personally, I think audiences will sit for a 3-hour movie if it's good.
Especially one of this scope?
Yeah, I mean, Avatar, Titanic were both around 3 hours, and they are the highest grossing movies of all time. I think if you have a good movie that people are engaged in and give a shit about, you can do 3 hours. Now, anything longer than 3 hours is just too long. But
the problem that this movie's going to have going for it is that, yes, you know Batman, we'll know Wonder Woman by that time, but you're going to be introducing 3 more characters that you're basically got to establish them and then build the story around it.
Well, and honestly, it means Justice League is probably going to continue with the same tone and the same idea that they did with Batman v Superman that made a lot of people angry, is they said, hey, we expect people to watch this to think a little bit. We're not Marvel. We're not going to lay it all out in front of you. And, you know, I know that's not a popular way of doing things, but personally, I kind of like the fact that DC is just shoving all this down our throat and expecting us to be able to just handle it.
Yeah, that's not the first time I've heard you say that, but I think DC will do a good job of... They cater to, like you said, they cater to a different audience.
Well, think about how long... Like, I mean, I don't want to rehash this, because I think we talked about it last week, and we could honestly have this conversation every single week, but think about how long it took Marvel to set up their universe to get to the Avengers. What was it, 5 movies, 4 movies? You know, or I think just to get to, I mean, look how big their universe is now, but how many movies it take to get there. You know, this is only DC say it. Wonder Woman will be their 4th movie. Justice League is going to be their 5th movie, and they have made this universe so massive already.
I think what sums it up for me is when I talked to one of my coworkers, and she's a nice person, but she was like, She said she likes the Marvel movies because they're easy to understand, and she's not the smartest person in the world. I'm just gonna say that, and she hates all the DC movies because they're just too complicated, and you know she just doesn't get what's going on. But Marvel's great because they just make it nice and easy for her, and,
well, and that's
like, I understand that, and. But that's why I think DC movies are so much better, because they treat you like a fucking adult. I like having to watch a movie 2 or 3 times just to figure everything out.
Well, yeah, right. I mean, honestly, I mean, I think that's why we loved The Winter Soldier so much for Marvel, because that was their first movie that really made you think about what was going on and really took you on a journey versus just kind of, here's our hero, watch him punch things.
Yeah, here's a funny joke.
Yeah, here's a funny joke. Haha. We're gonna use humor to skate over the fact that this plot hole is giant and massive. We're just gonna go right past it. And you know, and I understand the complaints about DC's quality in some aspects. I mean, Suicide Squad many times did not make any sense whatsoever, and they chose some poor villains for it, but...
Yeah, but it was still entertaining as fuck.
Yeah, and honestly, anybody who doesn't like Batman v Superman, I dare to watch the director's cut if you haven't. But to be honest, anybody who's a fan of DC has watched the director's cut of that and enjoys the movie like we do. That being said, I really do like what DC is doing. I know they haven't executed it perfectly. They've definitely not stuck the landing perfectly. But I do like what they're doing. I mean, I posted on our Facebook page, there's a clip floating around of one of the opening scenes from Justice League, where in the background it shows some winged characters flying around, and they look a hell of a lot like Thungarians, which if anybody doesn't know what that is, that's Hawkman and Hawkgirl. And there's a massive backstory with that. And if that's true, if they're bringing them into Justice League, it sets up... Anybody who's not familiar with the DC comic books, there are so many really rich, powerful stories in this universe, some really big stories in this universe, that a lot of people just don't know because the stories are much more adult. And everyone grew up on the X-Men and Spider-Man, which I love,
it's
too.
It's not like they haven't had 90 years to... storylines, you know.
Well, yeah, but what I'm getting at with their movies, they're not afraid to just do it. Like I said, they're just throwing shit in there and saying, we're building our universe. If it's got some issues, we don't care. We're just going to keep moving forward until we build this massive scope universe.
Yeah, and they're like, you know, you guys are adults. Figure it out.
Yeah.
I mean, yes, are some kids going to see them? They don't...
I still haven't shown the movies to my girls.
Yeah, DC doesn't make movies for kids. Mm-mm. DC makes movies for young adults to adults.
Which is why animated movies now are rated R.
Oh, God, and they're so good.
Yeah, we should have the new ones coming out. The Judas...
The Judas Curse.
Judas Contract.
Oh, yes, that's right. Judas Contract.
Yeah, so we'll have a review on that coming out soon. I know the digital just hit this week, so we'll probably get the DVD copy here in a couple weeks or so. But we'll have a review on that for you guys. But yeah, I mean, that's why they go rated R, because they're for adults and young adults, and hey, I'm okay with that. Our kids get enough shit. I want something for me.
Yeah.
If that means Superman punching Batman in the face, well, then I'm okay with that shit.
Where'd they go? I don't see them anywhere up there.
Way
in the back.
Look at these ones. See these ones? I can't throw them around because these are solid metal. You think they make solid? These things are like 5 pounds a piece. Think they make these for kids? Nope. I mean, they'll clank if I touch them.
You can do curls with those.
Dude, I mean, good thing I got massive guns. Ugh. Don't talk shit about my movie or else I'll Superman punch you into the stratosphere.
I'll jump on your car.
My parents are dead. Ugh. Shut up, Bruce.
What's your mom's name?
Martha? Yeah, I know Martha. Oh my God, we're best friends. All right, moving on. Moving on. Speaking of superheroes that I'm excited about that are not for kids, Invincible, a giant, awesome superhero from... I don't know if he's giant. That's a bad description. A awesome superhero from Walking Dead, which we're going to talk about later. It's own Robert Kirkman at Image Comics. We said 146 issues I think they're currently at where they're going to end it, but they're making a live-action movie about it.
And if I remember correctly... He's like the only superhero, right?
No, okay, so real quick, this movie is going to be developed by, before I talk about the movie, it's going to be done, Robert Kirkman's going to be heavily involved in this. I don't know if he's going to write the screenplay, but he's going to be a producer on this. It's going to be directed by Seth Rogen and Evan Goldberg. So, yes, it is that Seth Rogen. Before you think, oh my God, comedy, no. These are the same team that brought us Preacher, and if you haven't watched Preacher on AMC... It's got its funny moments, but it is not a comedy. I really enjoyed Preacher. I know people didn't. I can understand why some people didn't. But
it was good.
Yeah, but it's really good. So I'm very, very excited about this. So to answer your question, Invincible. I've only read the first couple volumes, so I'm not the expert on Invincible, so there's a lot of story that I don't know. But a basic layout is basically he's the son of... Think of Superman came to Earth, was the only real big superhero. He had... You know, he had his own Lois Lane and then had a son. That is who Invincible is. So Invincible is the son of the world's greatest superhero. And he doesn't get his powers until he's in high school. He thinks he's never going to get his powers. He's just like, great. And then all of a sudden, one day, boom, gets his powers. He's super powerful like his dad. him and his dad start fighting people, and then volume two, his dad disappears, and now it's just Invincible. So Invincible hooks up with other people who, you know, there's other superheroes who show up and stuff, and so he kind of helps, and he's trying to form his own, become his own superhero in a world that, you know, looks up to his father and stuff. It's not dark by any means. If you think Robert Kirkman, Walking Dead, you think, oh, no, there's no zombies. In fact, this movie, my guess, is probably going to be a PG-13 movie. This isn't like Kick-Ass or Hit Girl. It's not massively violent, so with massively bad language or nudity or anything like that. It could easily be a rated R thing, but I think they could scale it down just enough and make it a PG-13. It'd still get the, you know, get everything that makes this character cool. But I'm excited about it. It's a good comic.
Yeah, I thought it was the one where, like, he becomes the only superhero and he basically just, like, says fuck you to everybody and just does whatever the hell he wants.
Oh, no, that's, I have that comic. It's not Superior,
it's from Boom Studios, I think, isn't it?
No, it's from, I don't know, hang on, it's a Mark Miller book. It'll come to me, I can't remember. I have it upstairs. It's the one where basically Superman goes bad, decides he wants to rule the world instead of...
Okay.
Yeah. I can't remember what it is.
Yeah, we're talking about Invincible. So if it's got Robert Kirkman attached and Seth Rogen from doing Preacher, I think that's a good start. I mean, Robert Kirkman is a great writer. He knows what he's doing. And Seth Rogen's show with Preacher, I mean, it's not like a page for page from the graphic novel, but I mean,
well, the cool thing is, I think,
you can fucking get.
Well, the good thing is I think there's enough people who aren't familiar with the property that they can kind of do whatever they want to it, and you're not going to have... I mean, you'll have some fans who are like, no, that's not exactly like I want it to be, but I think a majority of people will be like, if they do it right, it'll be like, oh, this is really cool. I'm excited. If you guys haven't checked it out, I definitely recommend just checking out the comics. You can get most of the volumes right now for fairly cheap, either on Comicology or, you know, Amazon or your local comic book store, which we always recommend you go and see. But check it out, Invincible. Let us know what you think, if you're excited like we are. Another comic book character, since they're all kind of the rage right now, that's in the works, that has a lot of people excited, is Marvel's Squirrel Girl, who is a mutant, but is not quite underneath the X-Men, I don't know, Fox.
Yes.
Fox umbrella. Is coming to the silver screen. She's getting her own show. So apparently right now on, what is the show is that? Freeform, which is the Disney-owned channel. They are developing a New Warriors, a half-hour comedy show, live-action comedy show that is going to star Squirrel Girl. So I'm not super familiar with Squirrel Girl. I know who she is. She's one of the newer comics that come out recently. My daughter loves her. She has a tail like a squirrel and ears, and she can control squirrels, and she has the power of squirrels. But she's also kind of powerful because she also knocked out Dr. Doom at one point.
Okay, how does she do that?
I'm not sure. I haven't read Squirrel Girl. My daughter's reading the first volume. I told her when it's over, when she's done, she has to give it to me so I can read it. I mean, I guess I have Marvel Unlimited. I could just read it for myself, but...
Yeah, because everybody keeps saying, like... I mean, I've never read any of the Squirrel Girl stuff, but... I mean, she beats everybody in, like, a big fight or something.
Yeah, people love her. So I'll check it out. This goes along with Cloak & Dagger's coming to TV here soon. And apparently Freeform is going to option. There's two or three other projects in the works from Marvel. So it sounds like they're really... Disney is taking this Marvel property and they're launching a lot of stuff for kids that maybe adults would like to. I don't know. I mean, I'm sure it'll probably be cool, but hey man, the more cool shows we get. Marvel Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. just came back this week and it's kicking ass as always. I really like that show.
Been forever. That was a long ass break.
Yeah, they took a long break, but honestly, I think Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. this season's really starting to find its stride. I think the season's been really good. And you know, we have the series on Netflix, which we're going to talk about here in a second, but I think Marvel, in a lot of ways, I think their future might be television. As much as I love the movies, I think TV sometimes might be the best way to tell some of these superhero stories.
Well, because TV doesn't, you get that time. You get that elongated time. You have an hour and 30 minutes to try and tell, like, a really quick story. So, like, I think TV is probably going to be the thing that maybe it'll do a movie that, like, branches from, like, you know, a season finale or something like that. I mean, that's just kind of like what they're talking about with Dark Tower. But they're going to have the movie and then the show, then they're going to do another movie.
Well, and honestly, to be honest, as good as TV is nowadays, I mean, you can do a lot of cool stuff. I mean, look what CW's done with The Flash and, mm-hmm. and Arrow and Legends of Tomorrow, which I haven't finished yet. Apparently somebody dies. So I'll talk about that when I watch it, when I get caught up. But there's been, you know, I got really far behind on all my shows when Iron Fist came on because I binge watched the shit out of it. And so for an entire week straight, all I did was watch Iron Fist. So I'm still...
I'm behind on Flash, Supergirl. I'm behind on everything.
Which actually brings to the next thing. Did you know Iron Fist was the most binge watched show of 2017 so far? So all you haters, fuck you.
Yeah, I plan on binge watching the shit out of it this weekend to try and finish it up.
Yeah, well, honestly, it's not perfect. There's a lot of things they can do better. I feel like people were harsh because there's things they could have done better versus they didn't judge it for what it was. They judged it for what it wasn't, which, mm-hmm. you know, I feel is not any way you should ever judge something. But, I mean, I understand the criticism's fair in some aspects, but it's still enjoyable. I really enjoyed it. I thought it was great.
Trying to say, Brian, that the internet rushes to judgment on things without trying to look at the full scope
of
it? Well,
okay, if you take the whole whitewashing controversy, which is irrelevant because Iron Fist is a white character, so there's not whitewashing involved. But if you take the whole he should have been cast as an Asian out of the equation, I really feel like this would have gotten better reviews from the critics than what it did. I mean, Paramount, I think it's Paramount, who did Ghost in the Shell, has already come out and said that that the whole whitewashing controversy is what tanked that movie, because most people who aren't biased actually say that movie's pretty good. But the critics who had a bias going into it rated it harshly, killed it. A lot of people heard a lot of stuff. You know, Ghost in the Shell is one of those movies that, or did I say Ghost in the Machine? Ghost in the Shell is one of those movies where a lot of people were going to be on the fence and say, hey, is this good or not? Should I go see it? And because so many critics were pissed about the fact that an Asian lady actress wasn't cast in the role, just destroyed this movie, a lot of people didn't go see it. So, I don't know. I haven't seen it yet. I'm not going to say they were wrong because maybe the movie's not good, but...
A lot of critics, they'll just say, well, it's based off a Japanese character, so everything's got to be Asian, right?
You know...
No, that's not how a lot of anime and those kind of things are drawn. They're not drawn as Asian. I'm completely wrong. I could be wrong.
I'm not an Asian person. I don't know anybody who feels passionately one way or the other about whitewashing that is from an Asian culture. So I don't want to speak too much on it. All I'm going to say is, you know what? I strongly feel that when you criticize a movie, that's why on this show we will never bring our bias into something. We'll let you know whether it was good or not, whether it was entertaining or not. I feel people need to judge things based on what they are, not what you feel they should be. So,
yeah.
Anyway, but that's just me. So watch Iron Fist because I think it's fucking great.
And rewatch episode number 95, Iron Fisted.
Yeah, Iron Fisted, right in the poop chute. So, yeah. Like I said, I think Marvel is especially well on TV because their characters are made for television. Just like The Defenders, which is going to be fan-fucking-tastic, and we finally have a date for The Defenders. August 18th, The Defenders are coming.
And you got to see a little clip of them in an elevator. And, I was kind of like, I caught myself smiling, but it's like, I just want more.
Well, yeah, the only thing I caught myself doing, I'm watching, so they got all, if anybody haven't seen it, it's on our Facebook page, check it out. They got all four defenders in an elevator, and the first thing I thought is you see a guy in a bandana, and I thought, yes, Iron Fist is getting his bandana. Because, spoiler alert, in the Iron Fist series, he never gets his costume, which is super lame. I mean, I kind of understand why they don't to an extent, but it's still super lame. In this day and age, we got dudes running around in iron suits and blue unitards, whatever. This guy should be able to have his suit. So I see a guy in a bandana, and it's Daredevil, and I thought, okay, I guess technically it makes sense because Matt Murdock is the only one with the secret identity. But come on, man, if you're going to give one guy with the bandana, give me a bandana for freaking Iron Fist.
Why did he lose his suit in the last Daredevil?
Who? No, he had it.
Then why is he wearing a bandana again?
Probably because they were walking around and like, let's go check this out. And he's like, fuck, all right. And threw his bandana. Because he's wearing a suit. It's not like he's wearing his Daredevil suit. Okay. He's wearing an actual lawyer suit.
Okay. I didn't pay attention to that. I was just too...
Because he's a goddamn ninja, Ryan. Don't ask why ninjas do what they do.
Sorry.
How come nobody gets mad at Daredevil for being a ninja? He appropriated Asian culture. Or Batman. Batman's the worst for appropriation of Asian culture.
I feel bad that Stick was an old white guy. I mean, that's just worse.
I don't know. You know what's my problem is, like, if you want to be offended, cool. If it hurts you deeply, I'm not one to tell you it shouldn't. But come on, be consistent. Don't, like, pick and choose. Be like, you know what? I don't like this thing, so I'm going to say it offends me deeply.
Brian, you are getting dangerously close to our main topic.
All right, well, we'll get to that in a second. Well, let's see. We only have a couple stories left, so our last story is that The Walking Dead season finale hit a 5-year low in ratings, which, do not cry yet. It's still pulling in over 11 million live viewers. Yeah. Whatever. We'll talk more about that when we talk about The Walking Dead, so we'll move on. Let's see here. And then, should we do our trailer park now? Well, let's just talk about it. There was two trailers. We're not going to go in the trailer park. There was two trailers this week you guys should check out. The first was the new King Arthur trailer. This is clearly going to be a weird, different take on King Arthur.
Yes.
It's got a...
Watch the trailer and let us know what you think.
Yeah, check it out. It's got, Charlie Hunnam and... God, who's the director directing it? The...
Snatch.
English guy. Guy Ritchie. I feel like somebody said, hey, Guy Ritchie, you're English? Give us your take on King Arthur. And it's fucking out there. It looks... I mean, I think it looks cool.
Yeah. It's interesting.
And then lastly, there was a new trailer for The Mummy. Tom Cruise's The Mummy. Or as I like to call it, Justice League. Mission Impossible 7, The Mummy Awakens. I'm a sucker for Tom Cruise. I think this trailer actually looks pretty cool. The new trailer focuses a lot on the mummy, the new mummy, the girl, and kind of gives the origin of her a little bit. But I think you can safely check it out without ruining the movie. But it definitely gives away a lot more plot points in this than the first one did.
I just want a Brandon Fraser cameo.
I'm excited. I think people, if you're excited for The Mummy, I think this doesn't do anything to make you not excited. If you're not excited for Tom Cruise Mummy, then I don't think this does anything to make you excited for a Tom Cruise Mummy. Other than the fact that it definitely seems like this is the movie that they're going to kind of build their monster universe out of. But I don't know. I think it looks cool. And if you're wondering how Tom Cruise lived on the plane crash in the first trailer, this second trailer explains that. And I think that was it. Is that all the trailers we got? Oh, The Mummy also had a really cool poster. Check it out. It shows the new Imhotep girl.
Yeah, with the four stuff eyes, on her face.
Some tattoos. I'm not sure what the four pupils are, but whatever. I don't care. It looks awesome. And that is it. And that actually leads us to our last topic of the night, which is actually going to lead us into a little bit of a discussion that we had. So, Marvel Comics... I'm going to pull up the article here because I want to quote him directly because he said some shit that just makes you go, ugh.
Yes.
Can I just say that if I like to see that if one day I'm a VP of a very big company, that I'm going to be able to mince my words to a point where I don't sound like a raging idiot?
I think everybody has their off days, Brian.
And
he definitely was having a bad day.
But I think when you're talking about diversity and other things, you have to be very... Listen, we both said, I mean, me and you, I consider myself a social justice warrior. I think everyone should. If you see something that's wrong and injustice being done, you should speak out. You should stand up for those who can't. You should always, that should always be every good person's mantra in life. But there's
And as a man, you should not have to wait until you have a wife and daughter to decide that you can be a little bit of a feminist.
Well, that's true, but we're not judging anybody who finds at any point in your life, you know, hey, sometimes it takes things to open your eyes and see something from a different perspective. But at the same time, you have to also understand there's a lot of fucking people who just want to complain about everything. And anything you say, even if it's a little bit out of context, is going to be just blown up and people are going to scream from the high heavens that you're an idiot.
I'm offended that you just said that to me, Brad. God.
So, anyway, what happened was, let's see here. The Marvel's vice president of sales for Marvel Comics... anybody who doesn't know, a little backstory, Marvel Comics have been slumping heavily lately. They're getting their asses handed to them by DC, because anybody who's read the new DC Rebirth, it's been really, really good. Especially Superman, which we reviewed here on the show, which was pretty awesome. But anyway, Marvel's been getting their asses handed to them a lot, and Marvel's had a lot of changes. I mean, me and Ryan talked a lot on the show about some of the things they've done we haven't really been too fond of, and to be honest... I haven't read a lot of new Marvel comics, partially because I don't like some of the direction that they're going.
And you have a Marvel Unlimited subscription.
I even have Marvel Unlimited, and I honestly use it a lot to read old Marvel comics or Star Wars. A lot of the new stuff, I've tried reading a lot. Some of it's really good, some of it's really confusing, and some of it's just, I don't like it. But anyway, but because of a lot of factors that we're going to go into here in a second, Marvel's comic sales have been slumping. And so someone asked him about the sales slump and what the problem is. And he said, well, we... Stupid Entertainment Weekly. I want to see. I don't want to buy your ad. What he said is, what we heard was that people didn't want any more diversity. They didn't want female characters out there. That's what we heard. Whether we believe it or not, I don't know if that's really true, but that's what we saw in sales. So he basically blamed the entire slump of the comic books on the fact that Marvel has a lot of diversity right now and a lot of female-led characters. And then he kind of doubled down on it. Somebody asked about it, and he said, well, we saw the sales of any character that was diverse, any character that was new, our female characters, anything that was not a core Marvel character, people were turning their nose up against. That was difficult for us because we had a lot of fresh, new, exciting ideas that we were trying to get out there, and nothing new really worked. So he later, after everyone just completely fragged his ass on everything, and people took the why is that popping up? No, get out of here.
I thought you had a Mac, don't they?
I got rid of it. Anyway, after everybody, sorry, I was reading it in some ads, because ads, you know, one of these days I'm going to have a rant about how much fucking ads I hate. But basically after he, that's what I was trying to get to, basically after everyone just obliterated him online and yelled and screamed at him and called him really bad names.
Well, here's my main problem.
Okay, you know what? I was trying to bring up what he basically came back and said, oh, that's not what I meant. You guys took it out of context. So, go ahead. You can.
Well, it's what people need to start putting their money where their mouth is.
Yes.
And that's what's honestly happened. That people are like really excited. And, you know, they talk about how, oh, this is so great that they're doing this. You know, I'm going to buy, you know, an issue every single time. And then they buy the first issue and they read it and they're like, well, this isn't like Iron Man. You know, but Iron Man, and part of the problem, you know, they're doing something to these main characters in a way that just kind of trashes on all the history of them. You know, like, well, Captain America is a fucking Nazi now.
Well, and I think that leads to your point. So I think there's a few things at work here. I think I understand what he was saying. I also think that he was right to be criticized by people. I mean, he basically, the way his statement came out, made it sound like the whole problem that Marvel was having was due to the fact that they decided to make women the leads in comics and have a lot of, you know, diverse characters. I mean, you have, you know, Miss Marvel is a Pakistani Muslim American. The new Iron Man is Riri Williams, African-American lady. There is a lot of diversity. The new Hulk is an Asian kid. There's a lot of diversity. The new Ghost Rider is a Latino guy. So, I mean, there's been a clear agenda on Marvel to push minority characters into the forefront. And I think I understand what he's saying, because when you do that, your comic sales are down. It's easy to say, you know what? Did my screen freeze? Am I still moving on your end?
Nope, you're frozen.
What in the holy hell? Sorry, people, technical difficulties.
Your mouth is gaping open.
All right, hang on. There we go.
I'm back. Oh, there we go.
All right, okay. We're back. So, like I was saying, I think part of the problem is it's easy to blame the diversity. Now, I don't necessarily think he's wrong to an extent either. I do not think diversity is to blame, because the second best-selling Marvel comic for Marvel is their female-led Thor series. I do not think that people have a problem with diversity. That's not what I think. I think there's a couple things that have happened. I do think the way that Marvel has gone about it, in a lot of ways, has been wrong. To your point about their core characters, their legacy characters, is... So, one thing that DC does, and I'm not sitting here just be like, I love Marvel. I'm not a Marvel hater. But one of the things that I feel that DC's done a really good job of is they've embraced a lot of diversity and male-female characters, and they've done a good job of intermingling them. So, like, they don't just kill Batman and replace him with a minority female and just say, oh, here's your new Batman, deal with it. And then when it fails, yeah. Go, well, people just don't want diversity. What they do is they introduce this new character with Batman, and then they either give him their own story or their own comic, or they spin them off in a way that you already know this character, you're comfortable with this character, and you're okay with them having their own adventures. What Marvel's done is they've kind of just said, we're getting rid of the characters that you love, and we're giving you these new ones, and if you don't like them as much as you like the old one, well, we tried. What's to do about it?
Yeah, and you're an asshole. And
well, it's not Marvel doing it, but there's a lot of people online. Like, if I come out and say, I don't like the new Hulk. I like Bruce Banner. I understand why people like Amadeus Chow. I mean, he's a fun character, but to me, Hulk isn't a fun character, right? So if I don't
I just
like
want to see Hulk smash.
Yeah, if I don't like the new Hulk, people are like, oh, well, you just don't like Chang. You don't like because he's an Asian character. No, I don't like him because he's not Bruce Banner. You know, he's a perfectly fine character, but I want Bruce Banner as my he's my Hulk, right? Same with, you know, I haven't read anything with Riri Williams, the new Iron Man, so I won't comment on her at all. I've heard good things about her. But, like, for instance, I have read some of the new Wolverine with Laura with the X-23, and she is a perfectly fine character. She's really cool in some aspects.
She's always been her own character.
Yeah, I've probably read 12 or 14 comics with her in it, you know, with her leading it. So, I mean, that's clearly not enough to be an expert on the character, but it's enough to get a feel for the character, and she's a perfectly fine character. I think she's a good character. I think she does a lot of cool things, but she's not Wolverine to me. Mm-hmm. Wolverine is Logan. That is who Wolverine is. Just like Captain America, Falcon taking over Captain America. He's got some killer storylines, and I like him a lot as a character, but he's not Captain America, right? And so the problem is a lot of people online were the ones who, you know, a lot of these, like I said, extremist social justice warriors immediately start accusing people. If you don't like the fact that Tony Stark is no longer Iron Man, well, it's because you have a problem with a minority woman being Iron Man. No, I don't.
Yeah, but that person's also not buying those comics because
yeah, clearly, because the sales are in the toilet. Like, you know what? So, to the point with Jane Foster, spoiler, being the new Thor, they built that over issues. They built that over a long period of time. They set Thor up. He's always been a guy who could be somebody else. Blake, what's his name? There was another guy who took the hammer. If you had the hammer, you became Thor, those who were worthy. And so they did a great storyline of Thor no longer was worthy. And it made sense, which is why people accepted a new Thor, because it made sense for the story, right? What Marvel's really done in a lot of essence, it's not that these characters don't make sense, but they're really just shotgunning. They decided that they were going to become diverse, which, hey, good for them. They needed to be. There was far too many white men characters in comic books. And the women that were in comic books were almost always white, and they were almost always not as cool as the men, and they wore the skimpiest outfits you've ever seen. As a guy who loves female form, even I can look at that and say, I don't want my daughter thinking that to be a hero, she has to wear a bandage across her nipples and a bikini bottom, you know? So yeah. I get that there's a lot of things that they need to do right, but also just shotgunning into all your books, just saying, here it is, we're throwing every diverse character we can at you, and then basically making the people like us who love these other characters feel like there's something wrong with us because we also want our old characters. That's not the way to do things. That's not the way to sell comic books. And on top of it, when you do have your core characters like Steve Rogers, you give him his power back, then you turn him into a Nazi. You make Magneto a Hydra agent? Come on, man. His entire family was killed by Nazis. Do you honestly think he would ever become part of an organization that came from the Nazis?
Yeah.
It's, no,
Marvel's. I mean, you can get, like you said, you can give them credit for trying, but I think they fell short.
I think they fell really short. And like I said, go back to DC. You know, DC. One of the things they just did is they look at their stories and they say, how can we introduce more diversity into our comics and still embrace the greatness of our legacy characters, right? So, like, for instance, Green Lantern. You know, Green Lantern is a police force. Green Lantern isn't a person. Green Lantern is a organization, right? The Green Lantern Corps. So they said, hey, you know what? We don't need to have Hal Jordan, the same white guy we've had forever, and Kyle Ratner, the same white guy. And honestly, say what you want to, Kyle Stewart or John Stewart, one of the most popular black characters, and he's been around for a long time, another Green Lantern. We don't need these characters to always be the guys protecting Earth. We can have them doing other things where they still have adventures, they still have cosmic adventures. People who love them can still watch them and or read them and do the things with them. But we're going to introduce two. We're going to introduce a Latino male. Oh, is it a Latino male? I think it's a Latino male and a anyway, I think it's a Latino guy and a female characters on the new Green Lanterns of Earth, right? They have to, the way that they work, that their powers are new and they have to work together. They make a great team. And honestly, they're really good lanterns. Like, when I first saw them in Justice League, I'm like, I don't know who these guys are, but I immediately liked them. But you know what's great? Is I really like them. I could follow their stories, but I don't have to stop reading Hal Jordan stories. I can go read Hal Jordan if I want to. So in that way, you honor the characters that came before them, but you also introduce new characters. So that way, as a reader, as me, I don't have to sit here and think like, I don't have to read the new Wolverine and be like, yeah, she's great, but where's fucking Logan? This is Logan. Yeah.
That's part of the problem, that Marvel, like you said, I mean, Marvel just replaced people. And as not every single time the replacement's going to be even one-tenth as good as the original.
Well, and if you do it in a way that feels forced, people are never going to buy into it. You know,
yeah.
when every single one of your main characters has been replaced by a minority or female character?
It's all forced. And that 100% keeps me... I have zero interest in any of these new Marvel characters, honestly.
Well,
nothing...
And it hasn't been completely unsuccessful. Honestly, Ghost Rider, Robbie Reyes, I love the Robbie Reyes version of Ghost Rider. He's a different character.
Okay, if he's even close to what we saw in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., I'll buy those.
He's almost exactly like you saw in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Dude, I read like the first like 20 issues of the new Ghost Rider, and I enjoyed every one of them. The artwork was great. It was a different character. I love the fact that they kind of embraced his Latino heritage into the character, and it made it a more complex character. But guess what? Johnny Blaze is still there, driving around being Johnny Blaze. They didn't like, we're going to kill Johnny Blaze, and this is the new Ghost Rider. It was a great way to do it, and I wish they'd do that with more of their characters. And I just feel like, as much as I think Marvel, you know, and their VP, I don't think he's necessarily wrong in what he's saying. Yes, the diversity aspect of how you handled it is partially why your comic book sales are to blame. But you can't blame, I think it sends the wrong message to blame female characters and diverse characters. You know, Miles Morales is one of the most beloved new characters, and you know, Spider-Man. Nobody says, oh look, it's our African-American Puerto Rican Spider-Man. They just say, yeah, it's a different Spider-Man. It's Miles Morales. He's very much beloved. You know, it's good that they're making diverse characters and bringing way more diversity into comic books. But you have to go about it the right way, because you know, as much as people want to say, well, you white guys have had all your comics, you need to just shut up. Well, fuck you. We also buy comics, and just because we've had white characters forever doesn't mean that we shouldn't also get to read the characters that we love. There is a way that they can put all the characters, give us all the characters that we all love, and make everybody happy. I'm totally fine with having a black female Iron Man, okay? I'm totally fine with having a female Wolverine. I'm okay with having whoever you want to throw in there. Just don't also get rid of the characters I know and love and then make me feel bad that I'm mad that they're not around anymore.
Yeah, I'm wondering how soon it's going to be to Marvel to try and reboot everything again.
Well, and you know what? That, to me, is their biggest issue. Their biggest issue is even I don't know where to start right now. Every 3 months, they have a 12-issue event that you have to buy 30 other comics to tie in, and I have no idea what's going on.
Yeah, did they already do that second Civil War?
Yeah, that's done and over with. Now they're doing, like, Secret Wars 5 or some shit. Like, I don't even know, honestly. Hey, Marvel, get back to character-led comics that tell interesting stories and then have, you know, every year or every couple of years have one really cool event that makes you go, I want to buy it. Don't make everything an event, because when everything's an event, then it's no longer an event.
Yeah. So I think that puts a nice little bow on the end of that discussion.
Yep. There you go. As always, if you feel we're off base, me and Ryan are always more than happy to listen to other points of view. I go to bat lots of times with a few of my friends and cohorts about different various opinions. So I would love to hear anybody else's take. If you think we're wrong or if you think we're right and you have something that maybe we hadn't thought of, I would love to hear it. But as always, you know how everyone knows how to hit us up. And if you don't, at the end of the show, Ryan will tell you. So anyway. All right, moving on. So real quick, we just want to do a quick little recap, spoiler-filled discussion over the finale of The Walking Dead and, I guess, and or the kind of Season 7 of The Walking Dead.
Yeah, it's... Okay, I'm just going to say, this season has been slow. I don't know if it was slower than The Farm.
See, I've enjoyed this season. I've actually thought this season has been really good. I mean, it has been slow. I think the decision to go to 16 episodes was the wrong decision if you weren't going to add more action.
Yeah, I think they could have wrapped this stuff up to what they ended the season at. This could have been 3-4 episodes ago.
Yeah, no, like I said, every season of The Walking Dead's been, well, not every season, I think the first season was 6 episodes, but they've been 13 episodes, and they decided to go to the 16 this year because they said they needed the extra episodes to build up to the, you know, to the big battle that was coming. And all season long, they fuck you guys, fuck you showrunners, because you teased us the war all season, and we got it the last 10 minutes of the final episode? Come on.
Yeah,
man.
And it wasn't even a war. It was like a skirmish.
We are going to talk about that, though, because that was a fucking awesome skirmish. So we'll talk about
God
that.
God damn it. You should have fucking shot Eugene right there, that motherfucker.
Yeah, that fucking traitor. Obviously, if you didn't hear me a few minutes ago, that we're going to talk lots of spoilers about season 7. So if you haven't watched it or you're waiting, maybe come back in about 10 minutes and we'll move on to our questions and recommendations. But no, yes, this season was long. I mean, I feel like if you're going to give us 3 more episodes, there was a lot of really good character stuff. And the first part of the season was so brutal, I think we needed some levity in the middle of the season. I think that's why they extended it. I think there was a lot of really good stuff in this. And I think the season really... think about how much bigger the world of The Walking Dead is now than it was at the beginning of the season.
Well, yeah, I mean, you got the introduction of... You got more of the hilltop. You got the kingdom.
You got
the scavengers.
You got the garbage world.
The garbage people.
I fucking hated those people.
The people on the that were next to the water. What were those? All those women.
Know. Oh yeah, the women world.
Yeah.
So real quick, did you laugh as hard as I did when the leader of the garbage people looked at Michonne and she's like, is he yours? He's like, okay, when this is done, I lay with him.
Yeah. And Michonne's like...
And Rick's like, I gotta go.
No, Rick had that slight moment where he's like...
Dude, those fucking garbage people were creepy as fuck, man. Did anybody else not? I totally saw them turning on them.
Fucking garbage people who, like... They put like spikes to that one dude and like put him on like the weird helmet and
yeah, they were fucking weird. That whole thing was just stupid. But I thought the season did a good job of building the world. They definitely need to be much faster paced. I think if they want to bring the viewers back now, like I said, it's 11 million viewers, so it's not like they're still the most watched show on TV. You know, I think at one point they were up to like 17, 18 million viewers. So they've lost a lot. So I think they need to speed it up. I think you need to be faster paced. We don't need 16 episodes to tell something to your point that you can tell in 4.
Yeah. And I mean, like you said, we did this was like the first season where they really expanded on not just the walking, you know, not just them fighting for survival, but you know, building the communities that, you know, that are coming together. But they could have done that in 2 or 3 episodes.
Yeah, but it's so...
And instead it took about 7?
So here's the reason why I thought it was great. The thing I liked about it the most...
I'm not saying it was bad. I still enjoyed it.
I think... I would have liked to see a little more action, honestly. I would have liked to see maybe the beginning of... I would like to see the last 2 episodes with the war on the Saviors starting versus the very end of the last episode. And it was 1.5 hours. It was a long episode, too.
Yeah.
But the thing that I did like about it is I liked how the beginning of the season you took Rick and he was in one place. You destroyed his world and you completely, like, we had the first couple of episodes were some of the darkest, like, horrible things to watch on television.
Negan just basically telling them, like, I just put my dick in your mouth. Yeah.
No, I think he did tell him that.
Yeah. And you know, said, thank you.
And you watch Rick be Rick and then get broken down and then become, like, Negan's in bitch boy. And then over time, get to the point where he could once again stand on his feet and fight and challenge Negan. To the point where at the very end when he's like, I'm going to kill Carl... And I'm going to take your hands. And Rick's like, I don't care. And you believed it. You bought it. You saw that progression, so it felt real. Rick's like, I don't care what you do. Like I said, you're all already dead. You just don't know it yet. That shit was awesome. Because when Rick is in crazy psychopath mode, it's pretty fucking cool.
And Negan just ready to wind up on him. He's like, you know what? Fuck it. Fuck this guy.
Okay, and let's speak of the highlights. Negan has been fucking awesome. Negan is like my new favorite bad guy.
He's a million times better than the governor.
Oh, dude.
Million times better than any person that they've run across.
Only Negan could be the leader of a group who just got their ass totally kicked, and as they're driving away, he's got his arm out the window flipping everybody off.
Yeah. And he's like, man, man, this is shit. And he's like, and he said that, and he's like, he's still smiling about it. Dude, and they're like getting their ass beat, and he's like, man.
The best part is the dude's getting eaten by a tiger. He's like, he goes, oh shit, they got a tiger? He's like super excited about it.
And then
when it shows Maggie, he's like, God damn, the widow. Well, he goes, the widow's alive and strapping a gun. He's like, hell yeah. He's like, she's all hot. He's like getting a boner watching her shoot people, watching Maggie kill people. Fucking Negan is such a piece of shit, but he's so awesome.
He just doesn't care. He just doesn't care. And that's what makes him so great. And he's the way that he says his lines.
Oh, dude.
That's just another. I mean, he could have said, you know, like, yeah, that's shit. But he'll just be, yeah, that's like just like how he pronounces things. You know, it's just, he's really good. I love him. I don't want him to die.
Well, and the thing is, here's the thing. He's a person who does terrible things, but he's not necessarily like an evil. He's so much a sociopath. Like, he's just like, like, he doesn't really want to hurt anybody. He's got an end game in mind, and he has to do what he has to do to accomplish it, but like, he's so nonchalant about it. Like, the governor was fucking crazy and evil. He was just a tyrant.
Yeah.
Right?
He had his room full of heads. And
yeah, right? Where Negan is so just fucking Negan. I don't know how to explain.
He just like, you are hot, you know, and like, she's like, I'm gonna kill you. And he's like, oh god, I want to fuck you right now.
Yeah. Like I said, when Maggie's showing up, he's like, oh shit. He goes, the widow's alive and she's got a gun. Oh baby, I'm just like, Jesus.
Yeah. He's already got like 12 wives.
I know. You know, just like the thing. He's like, oh shit, they got a tiger. He's like all excited. The tiger's in this guy.
He's like, I want a tiger.
And dude, that shit was awesome with the tigers just jumping people and just mauling.
Yeah, and here's the problem. How does the tiger do? Like, the tiger knows, like, who's the bad guys are?
I don't know. Like, dude, listen, it doesn't matter.
It's a fucking tiger eating people's faces.
If you start scratching the surface, you're going to find some holes. But, no, I mean, I thought that end 15 minutes was great. There's some shit, like, this doesn't make any sense in The Walking Dead, but whatever. I do like that they finally got to a point where Rick was like, I don't care how many people die, we ain't taking your shit no more. And it definitely led to an exciting next season. Hopefully we'll get an exciting next season.
Well, they're going to war, Brian, which means it's going to be, the first episode is going to have a lot of action, followed by 6 episodes of.
Fuck! It's The Walking Dead. They're going to time jump 2 years, and the war's already over.
And now they're not even, like, they're barely even any dead people anymore.
Yeah.
The fight, so.
Yeah, because only, Sasha was, like, the only main character that died in the left season finale?
Yeah. Gosh, would you even do that? Would you kill yourself?
Would I? No.
Yeah.
I'm too awesome to die. I don't want to die. But no, I mean, and honestly, Sasha, it wasn't sad. You saw that coming forever, man. She was, like, moping around all season. And I actually thought they did it was kind of cool the way that they did it with her. The way that she sacrificed. I actually enjoyed her.
It was that close.
Yeah. You know what, though? So I'm watching this. I just expected her dead body to fall out. I honestly forgot that they turned into zombies.
Yeah.
For a minute, I was like, oh, shit, it's a zombie. And I was like, oh, I can't believe I forgot that she would turn into a zombie after she died. But I like, even Negan then, he's like, oh, shit. <She's> like, dude, Negan, I'm sorry, Negan stole the show. He was almost too great in this because Rick was so great, but then his final moments in this whole episode were just so amazing. Me and my wife were both just laughing watching this. Like, what is this?
Yeah.
Look at Negan's flipping everybody off as they're driving away.
I feel kind of bad that the bad guy is not one of my favorite characters.
Yeah.
And he's a fucking terrible, horrible human being.
But you can't stop smiling
when he's on the screen.
Yeah, well, I mean, spoiler alert, I don't know if anybody wants to know this, but in the comic books, in the comic books, Rick takes Negan prisoner, and Negan kind of goes on a redemption arc, and he works with Rick. So far in the comics, yeah. Rick hasn't killed Negan. In fact, Negan works for Rick now in the comics.
Yeah, and he killed someone really important in the last one.
Who?
Negan.
In the last comic?
In the last... Before the current arc, he killed someone, and he said, "Ooh, wait until Rick gets a look at you."
And he had
the head.
Oh, I don't think I've seen that. I don't think I've heard about that one. I haven't read that far.
I haven't either. I accidentally saw it on
Wikipedia.
Yeah, it was an accident.
Whatever. Well, anyway, let's wrap up our discussion here. Unless you got anything else you want to talk about this season on The Walking Dead.
I think. Overall, I'll give the season a B.
Yeah, I'd give it a B+. It could have
been better. But, I mean, I still enjoyed it. It's the only fucking show that I watched every week.
Yeah.
I mean...
No, I enjoyed the season of The Walking Dead. I give it a solid B+. It definitely lagged. I think the additional 3 episodes... I think next season, if you're going to do 16, you have to give us more... You have to go faster, or you have to give us some more action. There was a lot of episodes that just were people hanging out doing stuff, which I enjoy. Listen, I get this show as a character drama, so I'm okay with that. But we definitely need a little more action in between if you're going to give us that long of a season.
It's good job. You did your one season where you did some world building,
mm-hmm.
setting up Alexandria and everything.
Well, let's get to it. I think ultimately at the end of the season, the job is that, did you enjoy the season? Are you excited for the next season? And I think they accomplished that. I wanted to see more at the end of this season. So as always with The Walking Dead, it's a tiny bit frustrating, but I'm excited for next season. So, you know, kudos to you guys. Yeah. So we thought it was pretty good. All right. Also real quick, I'd like to just take a second and say, if you guys haven't watched the Black Sails, watch Black Sails. The season finale just happened last week, and it was one of the best season finales I've seen, or series finales I've seen of a show. Cannot recommend Black Sails enough. Watch Black Sails. Check it out. It is a fantastic show. If you want to see how you should always end a series, watch Black Sails. It's one of the best series finales I've ever seen. So,
you know what else is awesome, Brian?
Questions from the Faithful 50.
How did you know I was going to go?
Because I'm fucking a genius.
Yes, like Brian said, we have two questions from our ever faithful. I think Brian and Jeff are the only people that have been leaving questions lately.
No, we got a third one.
Okay, oh yes, we have a third one. Thank you once again, Brian and Jeff, for staying strong.
Well, and to Ryan's point, you guys consistently come not only with questions, but really good, thoughtful questions every single week.
Yes. So, let's start. We have Brian, and he wants to know, what was the last TV show that you binge-watched? What is the longest time spent consecutively watching one show? I'm going to say for me, it was the second season of Daredevil, where I think I got through the whole thing in 1 week. And I was watching like 2-3 episodes a night just to like try and get caught up.
I'm staying up super late.
But the longest pet, God, you know, if I didn't have children and a wife, I would probably spend like a solid weekend just to get through it. I could, you know, just get a bag of Cheez-Its and some, you know, a 6-pack of Coke. And I could sit down and do a whole weekend. But man, I think the longest I got, I think I did 4 episodes one day when I was on my job training where I didn't have anybody around.
Nice.
So... But man, I did not get those kind of opportunities anymore. Those long hour breaks, I'm lucky to get 2, squeak out 3 at the most. But what about you? What's the... Well, you just said with the last year you binge watched.
Well, so I just binge watched Iron Fist, but that took, let's see, I started on a Friday and I was done by Wednesday. So that's pretty fast for, honestly, for me with kids and a life. I think the last series, so I happened to go on vacation the weekend that Daredevil season one came out. So I watched all of Daredevil season one in 2.5 days. So that was, dude, that season was so good. Me and my wife sat down and watched the first 6 episodes of Stranger Things back to back to back, and then watched the final 2 the next morning. So that's pretty good. But I have to say that, let me think here. I was thinking about this earlier, Brian, when you posted the question. And I came back to, I was thinking, well, those are what I, my longest, but I forgot. So when I had my wisdom teeth pulled years ago, my brother-in-law loaned me season 1 of 24. I'd never seen 24. So I sat and literally over 2 days watched all 24 episodes of 24.
Oh, my God.
That is the most I've ever watched.
Over an hour long.
Yes. I told you. I was for 3 days, I sat by myself. I was before I had kids. I had my wisdom teeth pulled. I was just high. My nerves were completely shot. Like, that show is so intense, and you're just, like, on the edge of your seat the entire time. I have yet to watch another season because that one just broke me. But that is the most I've watched. I watched an entire season, a 24-episode season, in 2 days of 24. There you go.
Good old Kirkman.
Yeah.
Thank you, Brian. That's a good question.
Yep.
And let's see. Next, we have Jeff. We're going to start off with a little story, because a good question should always start with a good story. So Jeff says, so this week he's had 2 facepalm instances regarding his significant other and Jeff's nerd culture. First of all, get used to it, Jeff, because it's just going to continue happening for a very long time.
Oh, yeah.
Since he's the first and said while they were searching for something to watch on TV, and since he had the remote, they ended up on Batman vs. Superman on HBO, which is always a good choice. And she had never seen the movie. She didn't care to. And when the part where Wonder Woman jumps out in front of Batman, his significant other, who shall not be named for certain reasons.
Legal reasons.
She said, who's that supposed to be? And Jeff's reply was, that's Wonder Woman. And apparently she didn't know.
Okay, that, you know what, that goes beyond. My wife doesn't like comics and she knows who Wonder Woman is. So that's just... She's going out of her way to not know who... Jeff, first of all, I think that the story, moral of this story is, why is your wife lying to you? She clearly knows who this is. She's living in the closet and you've got to coax her out, because everybody knows who Wonder Woman is.
Yeah, she needs to get a shirt or something.
Or maybe you should get her a shirt. Maybe you're failing as a geek husband.
Yes, maybe you need to get her one of those, like, costumes.
No, I would not suggest that to start with.
You wouldn't go that far?
No, I would definitely go that far, but just don't start with that. Don't lead with that.
Oh, okay. You'd be like, hey, honey, so you want to put this on before we go to bed?
No, you lead with, like, hey, honey, how about this really cool workout shirt I got for you that says, like, I'm in charge, I have the lasso, or something like that. She'll be like, oh, that's really cool, what's that mean? Oh, it's from Wonder Woman, who's that? And then you slowly work her up to the sexy Wonder Woman outfit.
Yeah. Not me, just jump right into it, Jeff.
That is why you fail.
Alright, and so his second question was, this is a little more sports, and very Seattle sports, if you don't recognize. There's a Sean Kemp commercial on, which I had no... Is Sean Kemp still fucking around Seattle?
Yes, of course. Sean Kemp. He's got a restaurant out here called Oscars.
Oh, okay.
He'll actually show up and, like, hang out with you if you buy a sandwich. He's got 27 kids to feed.
So apparently she did not know who that was. And so Jeff said, well, that's Sean Kemp. And she said, well, who did he play for? And Jeff said that was his second facepalm. So I can't remember where your significant other is from. I really hope she's not from Seattle. But it might be slightly forgivable because the Sonics are no longer around.
No longer
so
here,
maybe.
Yeah.
Right. So, Brian, so now let's get to this question. When has your wife or significant other that is not geeky, which both of our wives are not, has made you facepalm regarding your geekdom. What is? Have you had those moments?
You know, I don't really have any moments with my significant other. She just doesn't like comics, so there's not anything that surprises me. So, I mean, she was mad at me because she watched 2 minutes the other day. I've been trying to get my wife to watch Game of Thrones, and so she comes to me the other day, and she's like, you know what? I tried watching your stupid show, and I'm like, what stupid show? I got a lot of shows you think are stupid. She goes,
yeah.
The Game of Thrones one. I was like, oh, you started watching? She's like, yeah. She goes, all I know is there was dead bodies all over the place in a circle, and it was not like a zombie show. They did not get up and start eating people. I'm like, you watched like 30 seconds. Did you see the White Walkers? No, I just turned it off because it was so stupid. I was just like, oh, what? How do you watch 30 seconds of a show and decide immediately that it's just dumb and call it off?
And
I feel like I'm playing a game with her. I feel like I'm playing a Game of Thrones just the tip with her, right? Like, hey, let me just the tip a little bit. Let's see if you like this.
I think.
But hey, real quick, okay. I do have another one. I consider this person okay. kind of like a significant other, but Jeff, I've had a lot of facepalm moments with Ryan every time I talk to him about Star Wars and he doesn't know where Echo Base is or, you know.
I'm pretty sure
one's an actual movie or tells me he's going to see Star Wars 8 when it comes out on HBO. I'm just like, oh.
I never said that.
Yeah, when you're like, what's a Jedi Knight? I don't know. Is Darth Vader, is he a wizard? And I have to just, Darth Vader's not a wizard, Ryan.
It's Harry Potter.
Whatever.
That's who it was.
How about you, Ryan?
Me? God, I've been trying to think. My wife is not into any of my stuff. And, like, I got her into Battlestar Galactica. Like, she'll watch the Star Wars movies with me.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, she remembers, like, enough of the basic stuff so that, you know, she'll just kind of ask, like, not really, I don't know, I'm just trying to think. I don't think I've really had, like, a moment because she's just so disinterested. That's my main problem, honestly.
Yeah, mine is
I'm just trying to I gotta like a lot of work just to try and fuel and just to get to the doorstep.
Yeah, well, my wife isn't into geek stuff, but she at least knows who Wonder Woman is, Jeff. She actually has a Wonder Woman tattoo. I don't tell you. Your wife is really trying hard to not know who Wonder Woman is. It's like, I know people who don't read comics and they know who Superman is. Come on, it's Superman.
Yeah.
Anyway, all right. Moving on. Thanks for the questions, guys. We do have one more question. He posted it last week because he got in late, so he wanted me to read it this week. So David from Washington wants to know, here there's going to be a live-action Pokemon movie coming. He wants to know how good it could really be and what we thought about it. So the Pokemon movie that's coming out is going to be Detective Pokemon, where Pikachu is a detective, and it's a live-action anime mix. Not really sure.
Is this coming out everywhere?
Yes. So, judging how well Ghost in the Shell was received, and I don't know, I think it could be popular with the kids, because kids like anything animated.
My son's going to want to see it, because he's seen like every episode of Pokemon ever.
Pokemon is definitely the one nerd franchise that I was too old to watch, and then it like went away and then came back after I just didn't care. So it's one of the strange, weird places, because almost everything nerdy I've at least watched or checked out at least once or twice or kind of enjoy. I have nothing to say about Pokemon. I mean, I know who Pikachu is, but I've never seen an episode of the show. I've never played one of the games. Never collected the cards.
I mean, I've seen a bunch of episodes just because my son he loves it. But he loves collecting the cards, but he doesn't want to like actually play.
Mm-hmm.
He just wants to collect the cards, and then he's got like a binder that's like this thick.
Yeah, get that kid
into
Magic.
For the card binders, and he just likes to, you know.
See, I'm still mad. Magic is the best card game ever, and I'm still mad that there's a lot of weirdos who gave Magic a bad name for everybody else.
Yeah, that's my son. I think once I introduce him to that, he's going to get...
Dude, Magic is great. Hey, word of the wise. You can take a shower and still play Magic, everybody. I've been to Magic tournaments. That is why people don't go to Magic tournaments. I went one time. I'll never go again. too bad. It's a good game. All right. Well, thanks everybody for your car or for your question. Sorry, David. We don't really have a lot of opinion. I think it could be. I think it could do well, but how good could it be? Depends on who makes it. Could be awesome. Could be terrible. Yeah. Who knows? I feel like it's going to be somewhere in between super awesome and super terrible.
Yes.
All right. So before we get out of here, you got any recommendations?
Speaking of something that could be super awesome or super terrible, we do have our recommendations, like you were just about to say, until I tried to cut you off.
We'll just do them together, since one of our recommendations is both our recommendations. Yeah. So this week, me and Ryan recommend
a little movie that Brian... Oh, you can... Yes. Which one are we starting
with? We
got
two recommendations.
All right. One of them, I got to see for the first time, Brian.
Oh my God, yes. The heavens have opened and Ryan's punk ass finally has seen Rogue One. He now knows that Darth Vader massacres an entire legion of rebels.
Oh my God. That was awesome, by the way.
And can I just say for the record, I felt really bad. My daughter... So
no,
Ryan's
let's not talk
son
about
couldn't
it.
Finish the movie
no.
because...
No, sad. Don't want to talk about it.
I told my daughter that, and my daughter started laughing. Yeah. My daughter is a cold-blooded assassin. I'm just going to say that for the record.
My son loves Star Wars very much, and he gets very attached to characters, and he did not like the ending. So.
Yeah, I didn't like the ending that much either.
It was good. I mean, I really enjoyed it, and when...
How shiny that is, when, Ryan.
I don't know.
We're not going to talk about it because everybody in America has finally seen it.
Yes.
Now you've seen it. So if you haven't seen it yet,
it's good.
It's super awesome. Go buy it. It's got the Blu-ray, the DVD, and the digital for $25. I haven't watched the bonus content, but I've heard it's shit. But who cares? It's Star Wars. And look at this cool reflective cover. You should totally buy
it. And when you turn it on, the loading screen is a little tiny Death Star playing that goes.
But who cares? It's fucking Star Wars. So go buy it.
Yes, it was awesome.
Next up, Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them. Not as good as Rogue One. I'm going to put that out there right now, but it's still pretty good. If you like Harry Potter, I think you'll like this. Recently, my wife watched it. She didn't like it as much as I did, and I asked her why, just for context, because every person I've talked to who watched it really liked it. She really likes the movies, but she's never read the books. And I said, aha, this is a movie that is written by J.K. Rowling. It feels much more like the book universe than it does the television universe. So I think if you've only watched the movies or the movie universe, if you've only watched the movies, you can definitely enjoy this. But I think if you've read the books, you're going to love Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them. I enjoyed it a lot. I thought it was a good movie. Buy them.
Harry Potter.
There's no Harry Potter in it, but there is wizards and they're fucking like doing shit. It's got the Flash in it. All kinds of good shit. Anyway. So check those out. Buy them. Buy them both. Don't hesitate. Just buy them. Spend your money on it. Get it. Do it.
You know what else people need to know, Brian?
Ryan, before we get out of here, would you like to tell everybody where you can find us, where they can find us, since they don't know, since they're already watching us?
If you would like to find us, we are on Twitter at the Geek Dad Report. You can find Brian at BrianWest53, and I am Big Boozer. We are on Facebook at the Geek Dad Report, and on Watch Play Read. And podhell.com. Don't go to those websites. They suck. Just go to our
website. You can go to Podhell. We're officially partnered up with them.
All right.
Watch, play, read? Not so much.
Yeah, it's going to die. And you can go find us on iTunes at the Geek Dad Report. And as always, YouTube at the Geek Dad Report. If you just want to see our lovely faces and sometimes Brian chest hairs.
You look like you're about to insert your microphone into your mouth. If you would like to watch Ryan suck his microphone on air, come to YouTube every week. We're here.
I was holding it.
Doing shit. I don't know. Whatever. Tell your friends. Oh. We need some new subscribers. We had a new one, and then we lost it. I'm very sad about that. If I find out who it was, I will find you a very particular set of skills that makes me a nightmare for people who unsubscribe to our channel.
And we're going to stand outside your window. And just have, like, big puppy dog eyes.
I will find you on Snapchat, and I will send you terrible pictures.
Oh, jeez.
That's right.
Make sure you get rid of them.
All right, whatever. Anyway, on that note, thanks for hanging with us, and we'll see you next week. And then after that, well, we got a couple more weeks. So a little show note, we are going to be taking a small break before episode 100 because I'm going to be out of town, and unavailable to podcast.
Maybe I'll do my own show.
Ryan will not do his own show, so we will. When I get back, we will do episode 100, and it will be glorious. But until then, we got two more.
I think super awesome want
episodes. What?
A solo Ryan show full of awkwardness and nothing.
I actually might find a spot in Jamaica to find Wi-Fi and just watch it live. And I'll just heckle you the entire time.
But until then, stay nerdy, everyone.
Stay awesome, everybody. We'll see you guys next week. Later.